Ja nende võrgustiku kuulub üle 2000 kooli üle terve riigi. Ja nende tööd on kirjeldatud kui lihtsat, selget, hästi rakendatavat ja samas hästi põhjalikku. Ja nende põhisõnum on, et kõik koolipere liikmed on olulised, kõik on väärtuslikud. Ja täna Niil jagab meiega, kuidas juhtida väärtuspõhist kooli, aga miks mitte ka klassiruumi ja millised on peamised väljakutsed seda tehes. Ja pärast ettekannet on siis kõigil võimalik vastavalt oma soovile kas eesti keeles või inglise keeles küsimusi küsida. Neil, the floor is yours.
This is on blank. Wow. I've always wondered what an Estonian audience would look like. Now I know. It's a real wonderful privilege to be here with you today. Jane, my wife, and I have been looking forward to coming to talk to you and with you for a number of weeks now. It's our first visit here, and I really hope it won't be the last. So do write to me and invite me and Jane again in the future. Thank you for the words that you've all said already. I find them inspiring, so thank you for your inspiration this morning. As I am looking at you, I am wondering what the pupils in your class or school think of you. I'm watching your body language this morning. What do I gain from you? How, if I were a 5-year-old or a 10-year-old or a 15-year-old, how would I feel if I was with you? Would I feel happy? Or would I feel a bit sad? What sort of feelings would I have? We teach more from who we are than by what we say. The essence of you is so important. The best teachers I've ever seen in the world are people who can connect with other human beings. They have that ability to make that connection with another human being. Teachers who aren't so proficient, just can't do that. And I just feel, looking at you all this morning, that you are a group of educators who can make connections. And that, may I say, is probably why Estonia has done so well in PISA studies. Because you know that students will actually make academic gains and social gains and personal development gains if simply they are happy and you are able to make connections with them. So congratulations. Please give yourselves a round of applause. You see on the screen your own city. I was fascinated to really investigate what your city and country and the history of the country. I've learned a great deal. One of my educators was the taxi driver who brought Jane and myself here this morning. Taxi drivers worldwide have the real knowledge about countries. That's what Jane and I have discovered, haven't we, Jane? Leadership of values-based education, leadership. You are all leaders. You were saying how in the British education system that there is a diversity, a broad base of leadership. That is true. And one of my own expressions is there should never be a hierarchy of relationships, only a hierarchy of roles. So if you want to be a really first-rate, values-based school, then everybody is equal. Everybody is equal. but everybody knows their role within the organization. In schools around the world that I visit, where the principal, the head teacher, thinks themselves to be something really special, then I don't see good education. Where I see good education is where there is teamwork, where there is cooperation, where those values are really eminent. And that's what good leadership is about. Leadership is about releasing the creative dynamic of everybody in the organization. Everybody. The teaching staff, the people who don't teach but run the office and other parts of the organization. How, as a leader, do you actually take the lid off potential and allow everybody to really do their best? You see Jane on the picture. In the middle, there's someone holding a certificate. Like you, we give certificates to schools that are values-based. They have to meet a series of criteria, and if they meet those criteria, then they are awarded a certificate. But the most important thing is the journey that those schools are on. That process of actually understanding what a values-based school is and looking at the elements of a values-based school. My aim today, as always, is to inspire. I work around the world inspiring human beings to take values-based education as the most serious part of education, to work with values even more in their own lives and the lives of their community and their country, and to make a contribution to the peace of our world. That's my aim. I hope you will feel that it is inspiring what I'm saying. One thing I'm not doing is telling you that English education has something that other people don't have. I work in so many countries now, I look at myself as universal. So Jane and I could spend the morning telling you the list of countries who have educated us. So I'm speaking from a universal perspective, not just an English education perspective today. That's David holding up the certificate. If you're wanting to visit schools in the UK, we can supply names of really good values-based schools to visit. David's at Bedworth is one of those schools. My journey, very briefly, I've been privileged to be a teacher. I call myself a teacher now, nothing else. I've been the principal of three schools. I've been in the English system a chief education advisor, running 500 schools. So I've done various jobs in the English system. But my delight and pleasure was when I gave up being a chief officer and returned to be a principal of a school, because I wanted to see, was what I was talking about making sense? Does it work in practice? Does it raise academic attainment? Does it help young people with their well-being, with their resilience? And so I wanted to see. So I went to a school called West Kidlington in Oxford in the UK, and for 7 years I worked with the community to see if these practices did work. We had, as you see, a globe outside the school, and the girl underneath the globe is called Francesca. And Francesca is holding up the world. Now that is a metaphor for the children of the world holding up our world with their values. It is your children's values that are going to make our world stay up or not. I loved what my colleagues here were saying to me last night. There should be a test for all of us later on by the students. You know, did we create, help them to be the best people that they could possibly be? A great thing to aim for. So a book was written about our school called A Quiet Revolution. I am a revolutionary. But I'm a revolutionary of the heart, not of the sword or the gun. A revolutionary of the heart. I have been working with teachers for the last 20, 30 years. Politicians come and they go. Their policies change. But you, my colleagues, are here hopefully for longer. We in our schools can make the difference. And if we have the support of benign ministries, then we can actually make a huge difference. So, a quiet revolution. That's Singapore, also does well in the league tables. The Ministry of Education in Singapore invited Jane and myself to talk a few years ago about how they could balance the curriculum, because they were worried, because they were doing well academically, but socially and personally, there were issues. The relationships with parents and children, an issue. Because the parents are working so hard, they don't see their children. So how could we introduce values? And if you look at the Singaporean system now, values are very evident in the system. And I'm so delighted here that you're not narrowing the curriculum to try and go up PISA's tables. You're saying, good, but we need a broad base at the same time. Am I right? Because it's, what are the characteristics? What's the character of our people? Are they resilient? Can they take the knocks that we all have in our lives and come up and carry on? It's all those sort of things we need to do, and values-based education does that. What's the purpose of education? For me, the purpose of education is the flourishing of humanity. Not just our own country, but all humanity. How can we do it? Colleagues, we're living at a time which is really challenging. There are things happening in the world which a few months ago I wouldn't have thought possible, but they are happening. How, as the educators, can we calm the system and continue to produce people who can make a positive contribution in challenging times? Here's a question for you. What's a value? What's a value? If I come to your school, I will come up to a child and I will say, could you tell me what a value is, please? And I wonder what they would say to me. Children need to know the definition, and they need a simple definition, something that's appropriate to their age and stage of development. So, One of the little phrases we've used is the one you're going to see on the screen in a minute. There's usually sound accompanying this slide, but so there's a little girl. And I'll tell you the story. Jane and I were visiting a school in southern England, and they wanted to be recognized as a values-based school. So we walked into a classroom of 5- and 6-year-olds. And I stood and I asked the question, what is a value? And that little girl who you see, without any prompting, she came up with a definition. And she's speaking now, but you can't hear her, doesn't matter. She said, a value is a principle that guides our thinking and behavior. A value is a principle that guides our thinking and behavior. Thinking first, behavior second. Many schools talk about values and they put it into the thinking domain. If you really want to be engaged with values, you have to do the other side, the behavior. That's why I always say values lessons in the curriculum should be experiential. And I love your dilemmas that you have work with. Dilemmas. Lithuania, I saw, were working on models, role models. So various ways of doing it. But actually, Unless we live our values, they are just academic. We have to live the values. Are you living your values today? Are you? Or when you leave here, will you lose your temper with somebody? Or be angry at a driver driving their car? Do you model the values that you talk about in your school? That's a challenge. Would you put your hand up if you're a perfect human being? Anyone here perfect? There's usually a man that puts his hand up at this point. I said to a man the other day, I said, why do you put your hand up? And he said, well, my mum says I'm perfect. The truth is, none of us are perfect. So in values work, we must always have humility. Humility. Values work is a journey. It's a journey of self-improvement. It isn't a destination. What is VBE and VE? And I should have put British values as well on that slide, I think. Values-based education is when you base everything that you do in your school on your school's values. Everything. Every policy you write, every bit of curriculum, the way you employ people, the way the school is governed. Everything has to be thought, well, does this meet our values? That's what a values-based school is. Values education, VE, are programs. They're programs to help children understand about values. So it's a subset of values-based education. Story of my life, going in the wrong direction. So you underpin with values, underpinned with values. Values-based education focuses on universal, positive human values. Universal because every major religion in the world, or those people who don't hold a religion, will agree that these values are the ones to focus on. I haven't worked in any country of the world that will not agree that honesty, respect, tolerance are not important human values. So universal positive human values are what we look at. In some countries where there is a strong Muslim or Christian or Jewish tradition, then they may call them, these are our Christian values or these are our Muslim values. I've heard that done. But basically they're universal because they're everywhere. Positive human values. Positive human values. Now, Howard Gardner invented intelligences, and I felt he left one out. I believe we teach about values-based education in order to help children have ethical intelligence. Ethical intelligence. Once you have these values really in your system, in yourself, then you have ethical intelligence. Emotional intelligence is a part of ethical intelligence. It gives you those things. Values-based education gives you incredible competencies. When you are thinking of the competencies that we need students to have, some of them that values-based education give are the following. They give you an awareness of values. Number one, so you begin to act in a different way because you are aware. Number two, you have agency. Agency is an English word that means you have autonomy, responsibility for your own actions. In a values-based school, children take responsibility for their own actions. Communicative competence. the ability to speak as I am doing, or my colleagues who spoke before me. I do a lot of work with top organizations, and they say they want children. Yes, they want them to do well on PISA studies, but more than that, they want children who can communicate well, can stand and really communicate. Last one, but there are many more, and that is relational trust. Values-based education develops relational trust. Values work really is about relationships. A good school is about three things. Relationships, relationships, relationships. You really do develop a good school if you develop those things, relationships. So self-leadership, that's what we want in the world. And not a selfish self-leadership, but self-leadership that is based on our authentic self, the person we like the best about ourselves. Who are we when we like ourselves the most? It's when we are truly authentic and ourselves. It's a lovely school in Surrey, in England, that Jane and I visited, mainly Muslim children, mainly Muslim children. I've often said to colleagues in England, if you take the contextual issues into account in the UK, we would probably come top in the PISA study, because the difference in Great Britain now is incredible, with the difference of religions, ethnicity, backgrounds, and all sorts of factors. I think, you know, I'm rather proud of what we do, actually. It's incredible. And all the various people who are visiting us. So this was one school. What the values work does, colleagues, what you are doing in your school is giving children a new universal language. And that language is based on values. Imagine if Donald Trump and other leaders of the world started to speak in a values-based language. We would change the world for the better. I think as people who elect politicians, one of the questions we should ask is, can we ask about your values? Are they positive human values? Or are they based on another set of values? Greed, intolerance, and what have you. So my quiet revolution is trying to get populations in the world to say, come on, politicians, what are your values? We will vote for those who have universal values, because then we would all be able to speak in the same language, which would be the values language. Here's some older students. The point about this, in some countries, the term service learning is used. In Australia, where I work, in the United States, service learning. Service learning means, I'm sure you do it too, someone will tell me later what it means here, it means the students in secondary education go out into the community to actually do things. So you are putting your values into action in the community. That's where you really deepen the values. So you work on your ethical dilemmas, and at the same time you're working in the community to build up these words into action. Values-based educators are full of fun. They are full of humor. They are positive people. I'm going to just ask you to do something. Would you trust me, the value of trust? Would you? Yeah. Someone said no. Would you please stand up? I'm going to count to three. And then I'm going to ask you to do something. Now, trust me again. Would you close your eyes? Close your eyes and no peeking. All right? All eyes closed. I'm looking. Now, after three, I'm going to ask you to do something. One, two, three. Face north. Face north without looking. Face north. Is everybody comfortable with where you're looking? Now open your eyes. Look where other people are. You can change your mind now if you want to change your mind. And sit down. I've just given you a moment to stretch your legs, you see. Very cunning. Those of you who are facing that direction, that is north. That is north. That is north. Compass. Why is north, south, east, and west important if we are leaders? If we are leaders, let me give you a simple model. And I owe a lot to my friend Floyd Woodrow for his work on compass leadership. Floyd Woodrow, look him up. Floyd and I have worked for many years together. North, as a leader, you need to know where you're going. True north is, where's your ambition? Where are you trying to go? Where's your vision for yourself, your family, your school, for this society? Where's your vision? A lot of educationists look at vision, but they forget some other things. The most important for me is east. East. East is to do with ethos. It's to do with your values. I often think we should start with our values. What are our values? And then think about where we're going. Are our values aligned to our purpose? Then over at West. West, I call it wisdom. For those of you who are into Eastern sort of ways, you might think of martial arts and warriors, of, you know, those warriors who were going out to help the poor and that sort of thing. So the warrior or the wisdom, those are your character traits which are built on your values. So you see, values translates into virtues. A virtue is when you have a value actually inside you. It's what motivates you. It's what drives you. And that forms your character. Many countries around the world look at character education. Character education. And that's why you need your W, your West. And South. What's South? Well, you're not going to achieve your vision unless you have South, which is your strategy. Your strategy for achieving. I'm very good at the vision bit. I'm not so good at the strategies. I need people like Jane and other colleagues to say, come on, Neil, let's pin you down. What are you really going to do to achieve this vision? How are you going to change the world so it's a better place? Go to Estonia, they said. That's where you'll change the world. I don't know who guides your philosophy in Estonia and in your own school. I've been influenced by a range of great philosophers. By training, I too have studied philosophy. Aristotle is really dear to my heart. Someone called me, because I'm getting older, someone said, I'd like to introduce Neil Hawkes, the father of values education. And I said, no, I'm not the father. You have to go to Aristotle and some of the great philosophers to look at who those fathers were. Someone who really touched my heart a number of years ago, and I haven't got time to go into the detail of this, but Viktor Frankl. Have any of you read any Viktor Frankl? His book, Man's Search for Meaning. Man's Search for Meaning. Brilliant. His philosophy, he looked at the existential vacuum in humanity and said, What is it that people really want? One part of his life, when he was about my age, he decided to learn to fly. He wanted to fly an aeroplane. I think I'd like to fly an aeroplane too. And his instructor said, well, Victor, if you want to fly to the airport over there, and there's a wind coming in this direction, you have to aim your aeroplane slightly higher. Otherwise, you will end up going too far south. And Victor thought, this is very much like humankind. If we take man as he is, we make him worse. But if we take man as he could be, we make him capable of becoming what he could be. If we take man as he is, we make him worse. If we take man as he could be, we make him capable of becoming what he could be. So as I've been watching, there's a gentleman in front of me. Do you know you give the most positive feedback that I've ever known? You've sat there really enjoying, and I don't know if you are, you might be thinking of your dinner or something, but you give out and inspirational. And so many colleagues are doing that this morning. But if I were to take you as you are, and you were a child in my class, and your behavior is not very good, if I took you as that, I would make you worse. But if I saw you as something that could, wow, go there, then I would help you to become that. And that's what a good teacher does. You see the positivity in people, not the negativity. Man's Search for Meaning, I do recommend that. Very quickly, here's a head teacher in an English school. Her name is Pat Wood in Enfield in London. Pat Wood, head of an exceptionally good values-based school. Values. When I've talked to Pat, I've said, well, Pat, you've got to think of your values first. You want a good values-based school, but let's think about your values. Are you comfortable that your values are going to be of sufficient empowering spirit that it will meet with your staff saying, yes, we can work with this head teacher? So we talked about the leader's values. We then talked about her behaviors. Her behaviors. Our values and behaviors don't always equal each other. If I said one thing and did another, you would all lose your confidence in me. So a leader must ensure that what you say and what you do are adding up. Then you have the staff, and the staff have to go through the process. I know you've done this, of thinking about your values, and then you think about your behaviors. So does it all add up? A values-based school only works if everybody in the school agrees. If you have some members of staff who aren't agreeing, your values-based school doesn't happen. And that's where leadership is so important. The leader must ensure that the whole school community is values-based. Values underpin culture. Having great vision displays in a school is really important, like that one. If you were to ask me what value is the one value that makes any organization work or not work, it's trust. Trust. If trust is absent, then an organization flounders. Children. I usually take time over this slide. I can't today. My belief, and you might not agree with me, but when each one of you came into this world, you were all wonderful babies. Your mums, your dads would have all said, ah, you're lovely. That's how we start. what we learn from science is that we have built into us certain biological imperatives. We are naturally cooperative. Human beings do not survive if the baby doesn't learn very quickly to cooperate. So we have dispositions already in us. We also have another side to us. We have a selfish side to us, what I sometimes call our shadow. Thousands and millions of years of evolutionary process has given us certain characteristics which I believe are not useful to us in the 21st century. They're not useful anymore. Values-based education helps us, empowers us to take control of that side of our nature so that, as Thich Nhat Hanh, that great thinker, said, you water the seeds of positivity in yourself. You water those seeds in yourself. If you are in a family where there is a lot of negativity, a lot of unhappiness, then you begin to have yourself sort of encased. And that wonderful you that's in there can't really get out anymore. You begin to adopt behaviors which perhaps aren't very good. In the English system, when I'm talking to secondary teachers, I often talk about our year 9, 15-year-olds, and how difficult that year group can be. Anybody here teaching 15-year-olds? Yeah. You will know, as I do, that during that year and several years either side, the brain of the child is being reconstructed. Totally reconstructed. It is not the time to have examinations. It's the time probably not to be in school. But what do we do to children? We put them in school at the time when their brains are being reconstructed. Now, if a child has had these experiences of negativity, by the time they get to that age, they are literally kicking against the school, the system, and society. What can we do? Values-based teachers, educators have a lot of heart. This isn't soft, sentimental heart. It can sometimes be tough love. But you're able, as an educator, to cut right through all that stuff and you connect with the real person. You never address the behavior, only the person. You maintain your integrity with the person. Can anyone guess who that person is in the middle there? It's me. It's me. It's little Neil. Have I changed that much? Oh, dear. Thank you, Jane. Yes, that's me. So what are you like now? Did you have things happen in your childhood? The history of this country hasn't always been easy. You have cultural circles that have come round you. So what do you do now? What do you do? What does the taxi driver do who was telling me about the sadness of his grandfather who was taken away many years ago? What do you do? What you do is cut through those circles and you give yourself a lot of healing love. A lot of healing love. We can't do anything about the past. We can do something about the present. The present. Here's an Australian teacher by the name of Rene. Rene is a great teacher, and she is a values-based teacher. You can see she is. I can give you a test, ministry, a test for values-based teachers coming up, all right, just for you, so you can implement this test. You can. The system in the UK asked me once, Dr. Hawkes, can you tell us, how do you know if a teacher is really competent? And I said, just one test. All you have to do is look at their eyes. And you ask yourself, are the eyes smiling eyes? Would you look at the person sitting next to you's eyes? Are they smiling? Look at the eyes. Are they smiling? I don't know if I'm being translated, but some people aren't looking at anybody's eyes. Perhaps that's cultural. Perhaps we don't look at eyes in Estonia. We do. We're working on it. Yeah. The reason for that is that you can really tell who someone is when you engage them. I know around the world, West Indian culture, you don't look in people's eyes. It's rude. It's not good manners. But the eyes are the window to the soul. They're the way you see someone. In an English school, I would expect teachers to engage at eye contact level with students. Because once you do that, there is a connection being made. There's a connection. So perhaps some work to do on that one. Carl Rogers, that wonderful psychotherapist, he came up with the expression unconditional positive regard. That is what a good values-based teacher does. Shows unconditional positive regard. Because I readjusted my slides earlier this morning, you haven't got that word. It's attunement. One of Dan Siegel, I do commend Dan Siegel's work. He's an interpersonal neurobiologist. And he says one of the outcomes of this, the work that we are doing, brain work, values work, is attunement. Those of you who are parents, if you're successful parents, you attune to your child and they attune to you. That's what gives you the relationship with the children. The world. My dear colleagues, I'm an optimist. I'm an optimist, but we have lots to do to help our world. Our world is a little tearful. In fact, bigly tearful at the moment. Why? Why? Values, just briefly. Two types of values, positive and limiting. There's a great organization in the world called the Barrett Values Foundation. It works with governments to analyze the values of society. It has done it. It has run their work in most countries of the world. Various governments have not published the results of their surveys because a number of countries have shown that the basic values that is driving their society are limiting values. Selfishness, over-bureaucracy, testing too much. All sorts of negative, limiting values that hold a society down. So what we need in our world, as I've said already, are societies and organizations that really do work with values. But what do we do? We can do a lot. How much longer have I got, Jane? Gosh. Do you mind if I go on to 3:30 this afternoon? 10 minutes. Starting point, very quickly. I'm not going to actually do this, Jane, but we'll look at it. The starting point of values-based education. I usually do this at a workshop. I say to the teachers, I'm going to ask you a question. And we'll do this. If the answer is yes, put your hand up. If the answer is no, leave it down. All right? The question's coming up on your screens, and I'll say it as well. If your answer is yes, hand up. Answer no, leave it down. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. Are you wonderful? Are you wonderful? Look at this, Jane. That is the reason Estonia is doing well in the PISA study. If I ask that question, I'm sorry, in the UK, I have 10% at the most put their hands up because there's an atmosphere we're not doing well enough. And so there's a lot of stress in the system. Be wonderful. Ripples of something have gone through me. We will tell people, won't we, at our next presentation somewhere in the world that Estonia 98% of you put your hands up, and 2% didn't hear the question. Wonderful. Thank you. And of course, you're like that, aren't you? In your staff rooms, are you all up for it and enjoying yourselves? Because that's what a values-based school. Children learn best in an atmosphere of positivity. They learn best when things are positive. This is Jane in the middle. She's doing the hero's pose. In Ireland, they do well at the PISA study too. And they do things like this, the hero's pose. Before you do an exam or a test, get all the children to go. Come on, everybody do it. After three, one, two, three. Yes. How do you feel now? You feel good, don't you? You're about to do the exam. Wow, we're going to do well. But there are some countries that say, right, you've got an exam today. You're going to do your best. If you don't do your best, there'll be trouble for you. How do those children do? Be wonderful, be positive, go for it, and have the hero's pose. Those children are from El Salvador in South America. Why do I really think you're wonderful? Because you send messages to the future. You send messages. You are creating Estonia, colleagues. You are creating a wonderful society. That's your job. The future of this country is in your hands. It's that important. And that's why values are so important to us. How do you introduce values? You have, what I say, you have a forum. You involve as many people as you can in your forum. You ask a question. If you could encourage your child to live one value, what would it be? And you could all think of that. And you would come up with a list of values. In order to have an ethical vocabulary, a school needs a wide range of values that you are talking about. You cannot develop the ethical vocabulary with a limited number of values. That is a typical list from a primary school. In secondary education, we might not do it this way, but in a primary school in the UK, they would work through the first list in year one. One value a month, explicitly taught. We have something called assemblies, where the head teacher might introduce it to everybody. And then in the class lesson, the teacher would give an experience of that value. That's the explicit teaching of values. Over the cycle of 6 years in primary work in England, the child would revisit the value three times at a deeper depth. So by the time you're in years five, six, you would be really getting into the ethical dilemmas and thinking at a deep level. This is, besides the values-based ethical vocabulary, we believe in our work that reflective practice is key. When I started reflective practice as a head teacher many years ago, I didn't quite know what would happen. What did happen was that children, after practicing that sort of meditative process, and I usually don't use the word meditation, but now we have the movement around the world of mindfulness. Mindfulness. So I know many of you practice mindfulness, but please, the children will only do it if you do, if you do. Mindfulness is based on neurological evidence. It's not on any other. So children need to be taught about their brain. Jane last night talked a little bit about the brain. What makes us different from animals is because we've got the bit just behind here. It's called the prefrontal cortex. We've also got another side to ourselves, which is the limbic system. The limbic system is all the emotions and everything. That's the limbic system. The prefrontal cortex integrates our brain. And if we practice reflective practices, we strengthen the structure of the prefrontal cortex, which then gives children and ourselves greater self-control. And by self-control, I'm not meaning an imposed control. Oh, this is the way I've been taught to behave. It's not that sort of control. It's the sort of control that enjoys being you. And you might have something come into your life which is really difficult, but you're able to deal with it. It doesn't make you have, English expression, a wobbly, throw you off task. You're standing up. You're standing up. I don't allow you to stand up. I'll finish with this. One of my things I don't do very well is keep time. You're going to have to invite me back to see another 6 slides, because it was going to sum up good practice. But I'll finish on this one. Values-based schools are good schools because of the interior condition of the adults. And you're able to maintain your inner stability and your peacefulness. 3 things, values-based schools. You have an ethical vocabulary, you have reflective practice, and you have modeling of those values by yourselves. If you do that, my dear friends, we have a chance in this world. I believe we are 5 minutes to midnight. We can change things if we educate our students in the way that you are meeting and talking about today. Jane and I would like to thank those colleagues who have looked after us whilst we're here. We're having a wonderful time. Thank you for listening to me. I hope there's been something in what I've said that has inspired you. Thank you very much.